Hey everybody, welcome back to Colony Drop, a Gundam podcast. My name is Isaac.
And my name is Brian, and this is a podcast where we talk about the entire meta series slash meta genre that is Mobile Suit Gundam, from the anime, the movies, the manga, to the model kits, to even the video games, Isaac.
Speak of the devil, today we're going to talk about Gundam video games. Oh.
So the Gundam video games are not something that Isaac and I have played a lot of. Is that fair to say, Isaac?
That's fair to say, but let me say this. It's not by choice, all right? there is a video game conspiracy against Western gamers preventing us from playing the full breadth of Gundam games because the vast bulk of them are in Japan. They're only available in Japan or written in Japanese.
Yeah, it's especially a lot of the older ones that it's very true. When Isaac and I were probably prime video game playing age, yeah, it was probably harder to get our hands on some of these classic Gundam games. So there are a lot of newer ones that are coming out, you know, even this year. Isaac and I are old now, though, so we just don't have as much time anymore to play video games. But that's not to say we don't want to play them.
No. Well, I think I read on Reddit, like, the phrase is, the comparison is, you've got enough money now where you can buy any video game and any console, but you really just don't want to put the time into playing video games anymore.
Yeah, there's this great, I forget who made this comic strip, but there's this great comic strip that illustrates that exact point. Like, it shows you when you're young and you go buy a game and then you bring it right home and you play it, like you put it in your console and you play it. And nowadays, when you're our age, you buy a game and you bring it home and you put it on your shelf and then you never play it.
I also read somebody say that, like, you know, 13-year-old version of you would be disgusted by how little you play video games.
Yeah, they would be supremely disappointed in how we grew up.
How much money you have and how little you spend on video games.
To that point, there are an overwhelming number of Gundam video games. I mean, even trying to do research on this topic is almost impossible. There, because there's just so much. Like, I don't even know where to start. And so I'll tell you where I started. You know, I started thinking, okay, what are the Gundam video games? I looked up the ones I knew, which are a lot of the classics. But then I just started finding that there's just so many games from the 80s and the 90s and you know, the newer games that I don't even know about. And I counted based on, I went to different lists of Gundam video games. I checked Wikipedia, I checked Mecha Anime HQ, I checked the Gundam Wiki. And I think Wiki had the, like normal Wikipedia, I think that had the most complete list, but someone out there might have a better one somewhere.
Right.
But I counted 199 unique Gundam games.
If I
counted right. I tried to correct for like a game that was released on multiple systems, because I think originally I started with 250, but I whittled it down to 199. And that does not include the Super Robot Wars series, which has like Gundam suits, but also characters from other mecha series. So that excludes the Super Robot Wars games, which means there's even more games that actually have Gundam in them that maybe they're just not a completely Gundam game. Isaac, do you care to guess which manufacturer has the most Gundam games on their systems and which system that might be?
I mean, it has to be a PlayStation, right?
That's right. No. So out of those 199 games, yeah, that's right. Out of those 199 games, Sony has 92, and 27 of those are on the PS2.
Of course.
The next closest manufacturer is Nintendo, and they have 56 games, and the most on one console they have is 16, and that was for the Super Nintendo. So you can see a definite shift there from the 90s to the 2000s and on, but from Nintendo to Sony from a Gundam video game perspective, which is kind of interesting.
It should be almost no surprise to an extent, right? I mean, PlayStation and Sony are such big fish in Japan.
To compare that 199, I was like, well, how does that stack up to other things? And what is the biggest video game franchise?
Mario?
Yeah, exactly. So how many Mario games do you think there have been?
Oh, God. I'm going to cut underneath 300 and say, I don't know, 270? Maybe. No, I think I overshot. I'll go 189.
No, you were extremely close. So, again, I checked a few different lists. I pulled the Wiki list. I have no idea if it's, you know, 100% complete or accurate, but I counted 261 unique Mario games on that list. Yeah. So if you put the Gundam games up against the Mario games, that's pretty close, which is pretty crazy.
Yeah, I mean, to an extent, though, they have the same lifespan in a way, right? They're both kind of born in the, well, Mario's kind of the 80s, actually. Okay, so Gundam's older. It's a lot of games.
That's a lot of games, man. So the first Gundam game, and keep in mind, listeners, obviously, you know, those of you that are Gundam fans, you know that Gundam started in 1979 with the original series. So when do you think the first game came out?
84.
Very close. December of 1983. And it was called Kido Senshi Gundam Part 1, Gundam Daishi ni Tatsu. I don't know what that means, and I probably pronounced it incorrectly. Kido Senshi Gundam just means Mobile Suit Gundam.
Can you give us your impression of, like, I want your impression of, like, a Japanese admiral or an admiral of the Earth Federation saying that.
Kido Senshi Gundam.
That's pretty good. I like it.
Not bad, yeah. I've watched a lot of anime in my day for a white male, but
of course,
you know. So this was released on various home computers back in the day.
Let me interrupt you for a quick second. I'm sorry. Sure. Let me just say to our listeners, the vast majority of anime fans in the United States are white males, so this should not be surprising at all. Please continue.
But see, that's why I have you on this podcast, right? You're not a white male, so it's the
our listeners don't know that.
we'll never tell them what you are. But
you blew my Latino cloaking device. You know how hard I worked to make this cloaking device.
This game was released on various home computers at the time. These are Japanese home computers, so they were things like the NEC or the NEC PC 8801. The NEC PC 9801, the Sharp X1, and the FM7. I have never heard of any of those before this. I guess I just don't know my 1980s Japanese home computer history.
Yeah, I imagine these were like, you know, the original Apple ones or something like that, the equivalent, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think they were probably, you know, popular back in the day for in the home computing market for the, you know, in the 1980s. So back then probably makes total sense to someone who grew up in the, or lived through the 1980s in Japan. But to us, it sounds completely, you know, completely random string of numbers. No idea. But this game was, you know, in terms of like what kind of game it was an adventure game with it was kind of like a visual novel with certain RPG and certain shooter mechanics. But I think based on what I read, it sounds like it was mostly a visual novel. Which makes sense given the computing power of the day.
Right.
And it was based on, get this, episodes 1 to 3 of the original TV series.
Wow.
And, you know, it was called Part 1 because there was a Part 2, which was called Kido Senshi Gundam Part 2, Tobei Gundam. And that was released the following year, 1984. And it focused on episodes 4 through 12. So they, the Part 1 focused on 3 episodes. They went real big for Part 2. For another 9 episodes to get you to episode 12.
Wow, they really stretched out their content library.
That gives you a sense of how far the Gundam video games have come, right? I mean, they started with 2 little games in 1983, 1984, and basically 200 games later, here we are in 2020. That's less than 40 years with 200 games. That means you're getting at least 5 games a year.
Wow.
Which is nuts.
If you're a Gundam fan in Japan, you're always playing Gundam.
That's right.
Sadly, here in the United States, we don't have that luxury.
Needless to say, that game never came out on any U.S. console or U.S. computer.
Interesting.
Imagine that. Yeah. So how did you start your research, Isaac?
I started my research sort of similar to you. I went to Wikipedia and I was like, okay, this is a lot of games. And then from there, I started paring down, like, all right, I definitely remember this game back when it came out. This was the first game I heard of. This game sounds awesome. And this game, I've seen, you know, multiple playthroughs on YouTube, and I know, you know, a lot more about it. Right. So I was like, well, let me do some research on these, get down like the general gist of them, and then from there, I'll be able to discuss it on the podcast, and hopefully our listeners enjoy it. Yeah.
I mean, I think our goal with this episode is just to give the listeners who maybe haven't played a ton of Gundam video games, or maybe, you know, maybe they've played some newer ones, but maybe not some of the old ones, some ideas of maybe some games that sound interesting or that maybe you would want to go back and play. Because with basically 40 years worth of games, 200 games to choose from, there's a lot out there if you really want to play a Gundam video game. It's just about finding, out of those 200, which ones sound interesting to me.
And which are in English.
Yeah, and which, and certainly, and which ones are accessible.
Which you'd actually be able to play. So what's the first, well, you kind of already said the first game on your list, right, Gundam? Right, Brian? Was the original Gundam on the, what did you say, the NES, or the home Japanese computers, the Choose Your Own Adventure Mobile Suit Gundam.
From after that first game, I started to think, okay, well, what are the best Gundam games of all time? Like, if I'm just new to Gundam games and I want to play the best ones, which ones would I play? So I approached that in two different ways. First, I went to Metacritic just to see what the top three Gundam-related games are. And to do that, it was very unscientific. I typed in Gundam, and I sorted by score. And the top three, or the first one, is Gundam Battle Assault 2, with a score of 80 out of 100. So as you can tell, if that's the top scoring game, overall, Gundam games do not score well on Metacritic.
I was going to say, nothing in the 90s?
Nothing in the 90s, unfortunately. Actually, let me just double check that.
I'll just say this to our listeners while Brian researches. That's abysmal if you have such a huge, if you have over 200 games and not one of them broke into the 90th percentile. Like, what's going on with the with the design teams or the story teams? I mean, how are you unable to break that window or that glass ceiling to get to the 90?
I mean, I think it's probably games that are not original games and that are based on things are always never as good. Generally, I think that's a fairly reasonable position to hold, right? Given what we've seen.
Excuse me, GoldenEye was amazing.
That's true. I'm not saying 64. I'm saying in general. There are certainly exceptions. Yeah, GoldenEye being a great example. So maybe Gundam games get a bit of a boost from the player base, right? If you're a Gundam fan and you're looking for a Gundam game, I would certainly be willing to tolerate maybe not the best game in the world because it was a Gundam game. Like, for example, if there was a Gundam game that had an original story in the Universal Century that I wanted to hear about, I would definitely play it, and I'd probably play it longer if it was a bad game than I would if it was a bad game without being related to Gundam.
Yeah, okay, you got me there. We'll talk about a game later on that I've long been interested in. Sadly, I've been unable to play. But just looking at the game, I'm a bit unfamiliar with it, but it has a map system that I think looks terrible. But, I mean, I've never played it, so I have limited judgment. So, yeah, I imagine there's certain a conflict maybe when they're designing these games where they have to sort of balance it being Gundam enough and also enjoyable enough.
yeah, for sure. Plus, they've been putting these things out in record numbers. Pump out those models. Pump out those games.
Don't you dare stop. Whatever series is currently running, you know, there's definitely a window that they have to, like, maybe put out a game for that series or multiple games if they can, and then they have to move on, right? So.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Clock's ticking.
Oh, and I should say that the count I gave did not include mobile games. So I was like, you know what, I was like, I don't even want to go into mobile games if there's already 200 for consoles and handhelds and computers.
No insult to our mobile gamers, but let's just say that most mobile gamers are casuals.
Oh, those are fighting words, ooh, sir.
Yeah. I'm going to get a lot of demands to, like, fight someone in Hearthstone or something.
So, yeah, the top game on Metacritic, rated 80 out of 100, is Gundam Battle Assault 2. This came out in 2002 for the PS2, and it is essentially a 2D fighting game. And this is a really interesting game because it was first released in North America rather than Japan. But there's sort of a caveat to that. It's a sequel to Gundam Battle Assault from 2000, which was also released on the PS2, I believe. But that first Gundam Battle Assault is itself a remake of a Gundam game in Japan called Gundam the Battle Master 2. And that Gundam the Battle Master 2 was heavy on, like, UC suits. So it was all, you know, Universal Century based for the most part. I think there was a few non-UC things in there, but generally it was a UC game.
I like it already.
and so it's a fighting game. So, you know, great, which was really popular around that time. Late 90s, early 2000s. You know, that's like the heyday of Marvel vs. Capcom, right?
Right.
But in Gundam Battle Assault 1, they replaced the original cast with, like, wing characters because cater to the American audience, right? Because that's what we had received from a Gundam perspective at that time.
Oh my god.
But But, you know, like anything, right, in video games, you can't just replace stuff without kind of redoing the game. So what they did was they, like, took out the Hamahama from the game, which is a Zeta Gundam era suit, and they replaced it with the Wing Gundam. And the Wing Gundam is actually just a modified, like, Zeta Gundam sprite that has the same moves. Oh, and it kind of results in, like, a funny thing, because apparently, you know, both the Zeta Gundam and the Wing Gundam transform. For listeners who know both of those suits, the Zeta Gundam transforms into what we call the Wave Rider. And uh-huh. It's basically a jet kind of thing. And the Wing Gundam also transforms into kind of a jet, but they call that the Bird Mode. But because you just sort of reskinned the Zeta Gundam, that means that the Wing Gundam now moves like the Zeta Gundam. And if you know anything about the Zeta Gundam and the Wing Gundam, their transformations they're not similar at all. And so I think what happens is in the game, the Wing Gundam ends up flying upside down when in bird mode.
Of course.
If you compared its bird mode in the show to the video game. So that I just thought that was hilarious and a great example of how, you know, companies will go to all lengths to sell their product.
I see how they never broke the 90th percentile. They're just cutting corners left and right over in Japan, trying to pump out these games.
Put it out there, man. Sell your stuff. So that was the original Gundam Battle Assault. And Gundam Battle Assault 2 went a step further, and it replaced the wing suits in Gundam Battle Assault with G Gundam suits and Endless Waltz suits. And this was my favorite. At this point, Endless Waltz had come out. G Gundam had started airing. The Universal Century stuff had started airing. So, you know, they said, okay, well, for the sequel, we got to put that stuff in there. So they took out some of the old wingsuits that they had in Gundam Battle Assault, and they put in G Gundam, slapped in a G Gundam story, put in the Endless Waltz suits, but they also put in Gundam Epeon, which Gundam Epeon's not in Endless Waltz. It's in the TV series, but early 2000s, late 90s, you got to have that Dragon Gundam in there to stay edgy, man.
Oh, God.
Oh, and one of my favorite things on the wiki about this game is that apparently early versions of Gundam Battle Assault 2, they actually incorrectly spell Gundam on the game's spine.
What did they say?
instead of G-U-N-D-A-M, they spell Gundam G-U-N-D-U-M.
I'm gonna put the dumb in Gundam.
So quality control, maybe not the best. But that said, it sounds like it's it sounds like this game was really good from a gameplay perspective. I mean, you can find a lot of people online who say that this was their favorite game and that it was a great, you know, fighting game for the time. And that's probably a big compliment because, you know, like I said, this was a real heyday for 2D style arcade kind of fighting games. So for this to be fondly or favorably remembered, it probably says a lot about, you know, how good the game was. Now, granted, it's an 80 out of 100. Not in the 90s, like you said. I think Metacritic is pretty... can be pretty tough sometimes, and this old game, so I don't know how many reviews Metacritic is, you know, aggregating for this kind of thing. But, you know, if you were a kid back then, you had a PS2 generally, I think a game like this could have been your first foray into Gundam. This may be how people were getting into Gundam back then.
It doesn't sound good to me. I do not have any interest in playing this stumbling game that the design team threw together and didn't even have the time to, like, check if it would make sense or work properly.
Hey, man. Gotta do what you gotta do. So that was number one. So I looked at the top three. Number two is a new game, or a newer game, I'll say, a more modern game. This is Mobile Suit Gundam Extreme versus Maxi Boost On, which has a score of 78 out of 100. It may also have the most complicated name out of any Gundam game that I read about. This is one entry in the Extreme versus Arcade series of games. Wow. It came out in 2016 for the in arcades, and it's so popular that they actually just released a PS4 version, including a PS4 version in America. So you can go get this game right now. They just released it in July.
Do it.
End of July. I believe July 30th, yeah. Apparently, it's very popular. It's held its popularity in Japan so much that they decided to release it for console, which is great. It is a 3D, you know, PvP arcade fighter. I believe it's 2-on-2, I think. I know it's 4-player. And you can choose from 183 mobile suits to play as. So, holy cow. And the units, yeah, there's quite a variety in there. Because I watched the trailer. And in the, like, minute and a half trailer alone, I spotted Gundam Bale from Iron-Blooded Orphans, Gundam Double Zeta, Crossbone Gundam, Penelope, And even the Ifrit Kai from the Blue Destiny.
Okay, so they really went and put everything in there.
It's gotten pretty good reviews. Apparently, it's very fast-paced. So if you like, you know, third-person, sort of all-range, 360-degree, up, down, left, right, you know, fighting games.
All-range mode.
All-range mode. That's exactly what I thought of. I was like, how do I describe this? And then in my mind, Peppy saying all-range mode was perfect.
For our listeners, you know that moment in Star Fox where the R-Wing extends its wings? That, a Gundam.
Yes.
Let's face it, Star Fox is pretty much Gundam. All right, continue.
Sorry. Yes. So this game is it's an update to a previous game from 2014 called Extreme Versus Maxi Boost, which itself is an update to Extreme Versus Full Boost, which was released in 2012, which itself was an update to Extreme Versus, which was released in 2010. And the whole Extreme Versus series is basically a sequel or kind of like the successor to the Versus series, which also had a variety of titles with similar gameplay. Notable games in the Versus series include Gundam Versus Gundam from 2008. And there were a bunch of older titles that also had the Versus name, kind of like Federation Versus Zeon in 2001. So this whole Versus concept is now basically been going on 20 years. And even the Extreme Versus series is now 10 years old because Extreme Versus originally came out in 2010. So it's now 2020 and they're still going. They actually just released a full sequel called Extreme Versus 2 back in 2018. But that's still in arcades that has not been ported to consoles yet. But I believe that has similar gameplay. So if you're able to make it to an arcade in Japan, I actually don't know if it's in U.S. arcades. I'm sure there's some cabinets out there somewhere playing it. But that sounds like a pretty cool game to play. I counted about 16 titles in the Versus and Extreme Versus series altogether. So they're doing something right. I mean, you don't put out 16 games in the same series for them to all be bad. I'm sure there's a few clunkers in there. But no. Overall, sounds like a positive. So, I think if you're looking to get into a Gundam game today that's new and has a lot of players, this game, Mobile Suit Gundam Extreme Versus Maxi Boost On, sounds like the place to be, as long as you enjoy, you know, kind of 2-on-2 fighting games.
Why not?
Yeah, I mean, the trailer looks pretty cool. Graphics look great. Looks very fast-paced. Controls look pretty tight. So I would definitely check it out if you're looking to play something today that's very accessible, where you don't have to go, you know, track down a PS2 or a ROM of something.
Exactly. Man, yeah. That sounds pretty cool. If I had a PS4 right now and the time, I would buy it immediately.
Yeah.
Cyber Monday's coming up. There you go.
There you go. Get on that Maxi Boost On train.
There you go.
And number three, we drop all the way down to a 73 out of 100 for Mobile Suit Gundam Federation Versus Zeon, back from, and this is again another entry in the Versus series. This is the first one. This came out in arcades and on PS2 in 2001, and then on Sega Saturn in 2002. This is a third-person action shooter game where you sort of just play through the one-year war and you acquire more, you know, suits as you go along, as you complete more missions, go up the ranks. I don't think there's any original characters here, just kind of who you'd expect. You can play as the White Base crew on the Federation side, and then on the Zeon side, you can play as you know, Char, the TriStars, Rambo Rall, Dozel, Garma, all the usuals you'd expect to play as. And overall, this game has very good reviews. It sounds like it's a lot of people remember it as being, you know, pretty darn good. So it is a little dated now. If you didn't grow up in that era, I think in general, a lot of the early 2000s, late 90s 3D games maybe haven't aged too well from a graphics perspective. But if you mainly are interested in gameplay, this one sounds, you know, pretty good to check out if you have access to it.
Damn, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and so the top three on Metacritic was actually pretty varied, right? You have Gundam Battle Assault 2, which is a 2D fighter. You have Extreme Versus Maxi Boost On, which is a 3D fighter, and then you have Federation Versus Zeon, which is a sort of a 3D action game, which is like more story based. Uh-huh. So all three of those are very different, which is great. Like, it would be kind of weird if, for example, the top 10 were all fighting games, but they're not. So that's a good sign. That means, you know, if you want to play some of these games, there's kind of a variety of genres available to you. Because, for example, I am terrible at fighting games. I don't really have too much of a desire to play fighting games. Like, if I was going to go seek out a Gundam game, it probably wouldn't be a fighting game. But what's your take on that, Isaac?
Do you know if they're all from the same publisher?
That's a good question. Bandai's always involved. Obviously, I'm sure they hire different people to make the games throughout the years. It's got to be different teams. I mean, the same team can't be making an action game that's making a fighting game, I'm sure.
I wonder if they had like just a few core like employees that were sort of in those three teams or something. Like, if you actually look at it, like, I don't know. What was it called? Pomodoro technique or something like that? Where like these are the 20 responsible for 80% of the success or something like that.
Oh, yeah. Could be. You never know.
You never know. Yeah.
I don't know enough about Bandai's video game pipeline, video game development pipeline, but maybe someone out there does. The third way I looked at it was to kind of take a very unscientific poll about what people's favorite Gundam games were. Kind of just looked around. And kind of looked into some that I thought were interesting that people might be interested in. But tell me about some of the games that you found, Isaac.
All right. The first, not really in any particular order, but what I put at the top of my list was the first Gundam game I ever encountered. I remember there was a demo available for this back when demos were available on discs. And I remember playing it with my friend, and I was like, what the heck is this all about? Like, they're talking about the Federation and Zeon and like what's a Gundam and all that. And this is Gundam Side Story 0079 Rise from the Ashes on Dreamcast. So this came out back in the day, the Dreamcast days. This was like early 2000s.
It was 1999.
Okay. Almost early 2000s.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this game has you playing, it's a first person perspective shooter. Pretty lumbering though. You're part of the White Dingo team, which is this group of GMs or your squad, and it's during the 1 year war, and you know, you're on a mission, blah blah blah. So it was on the Dreamcast. Review wise, it was not great, kind of mediocre. But I think it was like the only Dreamcast Gundam game because Dreamcast didn't really have a long console life. And Brian, you should remember this game because it makes the first and last appearance of Astaroth, the bioweapon from Zeon that was going to make plants just grow nonstop.
That's right. It was one of our favorite super weapons in the super weapon episode.
this game always... I mean, I just kind of memorized the name Gundam Side Story 0079 because I always wanted to play it. I only had access to the demo, and it turns out maybe it was for the best that I didn't play it because you actually never play as a Gundam. And, you know, the plot revolves around Astaroth, which is a horrible shoot-in bioweapon. You know, oh God, I can't believe they didn't decide to make, like, it about a mobile suit, you know. I mean, sorry, a mobile armor, like the 8th MS team. It would have made more sense, but whatever. But anyways, that's what I put at the top of my list because I was like, you know, that was my first introduction to Gundam being a games.
Yeah, I had that one on my list as well, and I would really like to play that one day because that has the GM Sniper 2 in it, which is which is my favorite GM from the 1 Year War, and I think maybe one of the most popular GMs from the 1 Year War. So that's in this game. The White Dingo team gets a few units, I believe, at the end to use it. And I think either the last battle or the last few battles. This game seems like a real hard sell to me because it's called Gundam Side Story 0079. But you don't actually get to play as a Gundam. You only get to play as GM and GM variants. And maybe a gun cannon or gun tank, I don't remember. And this was put out in 1999 in America, which at that point, not much UC had really made it over here yet. I mean, you know, Cartoon Network hadn't started showing their UC series. I mean, there was like a really old dub, I think, of the movie trilogy, but that was way earlier than 1999. So I don't know that any kid, you know, with a Dreamcast, I don't know if you were the target market. Maybe this was for Gundam fans already, but I don't know how you would know about the show.
Yeah, it might have been, I don't know. For all we know, this was some corporate case of testing the waters. So they decided to dub it. They decided to change the language and then release it and see how it did in the market. Unfortunately, they released it on Dreamcast, which was a terrible idea because Dreamcast died. It was the final Sega console. And here we are talking about the mediocre game. Mobile Suit Gundam Side Story.
The only thing I'll add is that Dreamcast actually had three other games. One of them was Federation versus Zeon, also came out on Dreamcast. There was a Gurren's Greed game on Dreamcast, Wow. And there was one called Gundam Battle Online.
Were these English or?
That's a good question. I'm not sure.
Hmm.
Federation versus Zeon probably was. Gurren's Greed, I doubt it.
Yeah.
Unless you know. And then Gundam Battle Online, I don't know much about that one. I'm sure someone out there does. If a listener's out there who has all these games translated for Dreamcast, let us know. Does your Dreamcast still work? And can you send it to Isaac so that he can play Gurren's Greed, Blood of Zeon?
I don't remember what my Dreamcast is. It might have been sold. I don't know. I had enough and I was like, you know what? This let it die along with Sega.
All right. Which one's next on your list, Isaac?
All right. Next on my list was something when I read it was just a rabbit hole of awesomeness. All right. And I fell down it like Alice in Wonderland. You couldn't stop my fall, Brian. All right. Here we go. Game is called Kido Senshi Gundam Senjo no Kitsuna, which translates into Mobile Suit Gundam Bonds of the Battlefield.
Ooh, I think I read about this one, but keep going.
Okay.
Enlighten me.
Brian, if you can wind back the clock brain and think back to when we're talking about Gundam Land, our limitless budget theme park for Gundam, this game is almost as close as we can get to putting someone into a mobile suit, okay? This game is not available for your house or any console, right? Because you have to go to an arcade to play it. Because players step into something called a pod, APOD, which is a panoramic optical display.
Ooh.
And for our listeners, if you're able to Google this, Brian, if you're able to Google this, you're essentially sitting in a cockpit, as close as you can get to a cockpit in, like, you know, an arcade that you would go to. And it's got like these screens and stuff. So you really feel like you're inside the cockpit with the, you know, the controls in front of you. You're actually sitting down and, you know, you've got screen on your left, your right, and then the main one. And I think one above your head too. So it's very immersive. This actually got launched back in 06. So it's been around for a while. Arcades usually have four pods, but some have more. And the game is online, so you're not really playing, you know, just people in your immediate vicinity or, you know, whatever computer simulation or pre-created map and enemies are generated for you. No, you actually have a fight online in different factions. And it just sounds so awesome because it's about as organized as you would expect for like something in Japan that's clearly catering to hardcore fans, because there's a game center where you sign up and there's like automatic rankings. You can get these player cards, and you know, they keep your score. And if you go to like a different arcade, you know, your card gets like overwritten with like the last, with the current location you're at the arcade, and you can organize in teams. When the battle starts, you can communicate with your teammates, you know, across online, and it just sounds so awesome to play. Like, I imagine it, when I go to Japan eventually, I'll make it a point to like try to play this as best I can. You know, who knows how much I'll be able to actually understand what the screens and writing are. But for all I know, I'll like eject myself in like the opening minutes. But yeah, I mean, they said average game time lasts 10 to 15 minutes, which is pretty awesome. And, you know, these aren't your sort of dinky bucket seats that you sit in. No, there's surround sound speakers in there. You can bring your own headset because there's headset jacks. So that's how intense it is. I guess ace players are bringing their own custom headsets. there's foot pedals. There's foot pedals, Brian.
Oh, man.
All right. I can't say enough about how awesome this game sounds and how interesting it looks. Aside from that, I mean, oh yeah, also like any really good game that's tracking you, because you get player cards, you know, you can kind of take your card with you and kind of like keys you in, I guess, as you come back for more games, you know, as you go around Japan, I guess. You sort of gain points, so it tracks how good you actually are in the game. So you can sort of determine, I guess, when you log to, you know, their entry kind of scoreboard kiosk area. You can set it so that you only fight people close to your advanced level or what have you, so you can avoid fighting beginners and all that. So it sounds pretty complex and sophisticated. They made it almost as tournament-like as they could, and it has a lot of different Gundams. Some Gundams that, you know, I'm surprised are there, like Alex is there. Blue Destiny, you can also play as a ball.
they get very
meta too with the ranks that you get as you go on. You start as a civilian, but you go all the way up to like general. So there's like about a dozen ranks, and as far as battlefields, they have every battlefield you would want. There's California base, there's multiple Jabra levels.
You can't just have one.
There's some areas that, like, I'm surprised they're there, like Torrington Base from 0083. Like, what the hell is that there? it was in, like, two episodes. So, there's a Bawaku. It's just, I don't know. It sounds about as immersive of an experience as you could get for Gundam. Sadly, there's no evidence that it's ever made it to the U.S. I think the furthest they exported it was, like, Hong Kong.
Well, I mean, based on that, yeah. This sounds amazing, and I think we need to go to Japan right now and go play this game.
We're going to do it. After COVID, it's happening, listeners. This is Japan Cast.
I mean, we could basically just stop the episode now. I don't think we're going to get a better game than Bonds the Battlefield. I'm looking at the pictures of this thing, and yeah, it's pretty amazing. I want to play it. I mean,
that's what you would want. Right, that's what you would want if you're a Gundam fan and you walked into like a Gundam arcade. You'd be like, okay, all my money is going on this, and like maybe some drinks.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, and yeah, listeners, Isaac has always been one of those people that has always really wanted like the full Mech Warrior setup, you know, the special thing they sell. So I think this Bond to the Battlefield pod is like right up Isaac's alley.
I would like show up in my flight suit. Right? I would want my team, like we all show up in our flight suits and like we sit down and like for us it's real for like the 10 minutes that we're actually fighting.
Admiral Delos, yeah. I'm ready. Put me in.
Yeah. I only answer to Delos. The manager has to pretend he's Delos.
Could we create our own faction, the King Space Pigs?
We'll do it. We'll be the, the swine sides or something like that.
We'll be, like you said, we'll accidentally eject ourselves a minute into the combat. I'm sure not being able to read anything, but
we'll get to this arcade in like Tokyo or Hokkaido. And then like, we'll sit down and we'll all be excited and loud. And like everybody watching is like, oh God, the Americans are here.
Stupid and then, Americans.
Like, we'll be defeated in like 10 seconds because we eject at the start of the battle.
And so ends our Japan cast. It'll be the most disappointing Twitch stream ever.
We just start yelling at the manager. All the writing's in Japanese.
how do you expect us to play this game?
I thought you were our allies.
Oh, this game looks amazing. Yeah. I really want to play this one now. Oh man. I'm sure you can, you know, when I went to Japan, there's plenty of arcades. I'm sure this is all over the place in like Akihabara and those kind of places. So shouldn't be too hard to find. We just need to make it over there.
Yeah. Maybe we can like buy one or like, yeah, we'll buy them. We'll install them in our homes. We'll connect them online. We'll like hire a programmer that's able to like translate it. And then that'll be our life.
Yeah, you just need one room in your house dedicated to Bonds of the Battlefield.
There you go. Yeah, so that was out of my list. That was probably the most awesome sounding one, I thought.
Yeah, that one seems super cool. Now I want to play that one. What's next on your list? I mean, whatever it is, it's not going to be as good as that one.
No, it's not. And you know what? This might be the bottom of my list. This next one is called Mobile Suit Gundam AGE PSP. All right. We haven't had an AGE episode yet. Let me just tell everybody that it's probably the most chibi Gundam besides SD Gundam. And it didn't do well. I didn't think it was a terrible story, but it didn't do well for different reasons. This, I believe, is the only AGE game. So that might shed some light on Sunrise and maybe Bandai knowing that, okay, this isn't going to do well at all. Just put it on the PSP. So it's also surprisingly one of the few Gundam games that I did research on that you actually play the storyline. You know, it's not a side story. It's not a fighting game that just uses the Gundams. It's not some, you know, bizarre story they made up. No, you're going to do the actual, you know, the beats of the main storyline that you actually saw in the series. And you just play through it. And that's the game.
That's the game. Yeah, I mean, compared to Bonds of the Battlefield, you're right. That one, I'm never picking that up.
No, don't do it. There's a lot on the PSP. You don't need to waste it on Gundam AGE.
But I think it being the only AGE game is interesting, right? Because of what you said before about the window, right? So when Bandai puts out a Gundam TV show, they're putting out a whole meta series, meta genre blitz, right? You're going to get your anime, you're going to get your manga, you're going to get your models, your video games, your figures, you know, t-shirts, all the whole thing. The fact that AGE only got one game really tells you how well that show did. Poor AGE, but yeah, short-lived.
What's next on your list, Brian?
And we're going to cut it there for this episode. Next week, we'll continue our overview of Gundam video games you might want to play, including Isaac's favorite series he's never played, the games known as Gurren's Greed. Please like, comment, and subscribe. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts, and on Twitter at ColonyDropcast. Until then, keep those Minovsky reactors warm, stay safe out there, and have a great week, everybody.